your usual look.
You can start rolling, because
I am.
Okay. Yes. Anytime we're going to discuss the hair, I think that's the kind of thing people want to know about.
It's not Shin Lim level.
Well, who can reach that level? We know Shin Lim's
It's not secret. Vegas headliner Shin Lim level.
We know Shin's secret.
Perform in Vegas at corporate now and then level.
It's the hair. If you have the cool enough hair. It's funny the progression of his hair, of like, as he progressed in his fame, so did the hair.
I did an entire a react to his AGT.
Oh, you did? On YouTube?
Yeah, it was, I think 700,000 views.
Really?
It was, we just kind of, but I was like commenting on like, oh, like Shin Lim smiled. Like he showed teeth. And then he does like a double wink towards the TV.
What's a double wink?
And he said one eye, it's both eyes.
That's a blink.
No, but when he does it, it's a wink.
Oh, sure. Yeah
so when you do it, it's a blink.
And confetti.
Here we go.
I usually do an intro, but I'm not even sure if you know what I'll do is if I don't have the welcome. I mean, I can throw that in.
Okay, let's do that. Let's go for it. Let's do a proper introduction.
I'll do a proper introduction.
Camera. All right, so hang on. I'm not gonna leave him hanging. For some reason, the video did not record his intro, so I'm gonna find that. So that's past Michael interviewing Steven, and that's at the 4F convention. I wasn't even going to be on camera, but just in case of an emergency, here I am. But let me show you, because it's so cool. I love his montage. So let me find it and pull it up. I don't know why it's not in the... So there might be a couple times where for some reason it didn't record, or it didn't render maybe, but because the whole video should be put together. But let me see. I'm going to find it here. And just pull it up for you guys. So we'll come right back to the interview in a moment, and it should be. We're gonna do. Yep. Open link in a new tab, and I'm gonna put that. Here. Hold on 1 second, Steven, and we're gonna play, because I love his opening montage, so we're gonna get that for you. I don't know why I didn't record properly. That's interesting. So let's remove this. Hi everybody, and welcome to Something Up My Sleeve. Well, it's good that I am on camera, because I have an opportunity to tell you about a couple of things. First of all, the IBM convention is coming up. It's what we have less than 2 weeks now. It's like 2 weeks away, I think. It's like it's right around the corner. It's there. It is. So definitely, if you're not registered, be there. It's gonna be a blast. I was just watching the video of my friends Trevor and Lorena, who are gonna be on the show as well, and I'm so excited. There's so many great people coming out to perform, and so that is the IBM convention in Pittsburgh. You want to register for that. And then also Thursday, so 2 days from now, we're gonna have a bonus episode of Something Up My Sleeve, where we have the new AGT star, Trig Watson, who was one of my first guests on Something Up My Sleeve, and we're going to have him back to talk about that experience. So that'll be Thursday night. Now I'm going to add, let's see, we're going to add share screen. Yes. So we'll do, yep, there we go. This one right here. And I believe audio is fine. So there we go. So I'm going to just play this for you and then cut it off. That was part of the video that was put together, so I don't know why that happened, but nonetheless, you know, that's what you come to expect from Something Up My Sleeve, because you never know what's up my sleeve. But here you go. Here's some fun with Steven.
Hey. Steven.
but you know, I can always cut it
together. Yeah, I like it.
So, in fact, we're gonna cut to a video clip.
Which one?
Well, I mean, I gotta edit it later.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Which clip though?
We're ready for, you're gonna send me some.
What do you want me to send you?
Well, something with a Rubik's Cube. Do okay. you have any of that?
Yeah, I have some of that.
So, okay. Proper deduction.
Send you a picture of my box.
Yeah. I want to see your box. We're here with Steven Brundage, and we are out the box. So welcome to another episode of Something Up My Sleeve, or a continuation of an episode of Something Up My Sleeve. And we have one of my favorite guys that I believe I got to meet in person here. Well, not here at this hotel, but at this convention. I think was the first time I met you.
No, we met way before that, I thought.
Quebec?
Yes. Yeah, years and years ago.
Before Fora?
No, didn't I come to Quebec City? And then at the castle, I feel like.
No,
I saw your show. I've seen your show at the castle. Maybe you didn't know.
I've never performed at the castle.
You never have?
No, but guess what? I've never have, but guess what? Next month, my first time.
Maybe it's because I've seen your videotapes. I don't know. It's in the magic community, like you just feel like you know people since like, you see them online, and you know we're all friends of friends.
Yeah.
You know?
We're gonna figure that out because I want to say it was here, but nonetheless. Known for his amazing work with the Rubik's Cube, but also has just become, I would say, a magician's magician and extremely likable guy. We're going to talk about how does he remain so likable. But I've actually tried to set this up for the longest time on like a Zoom call. I finally get him on location we're now at the 4F convention. And your second time at this convention.
Yeah.
And I pride you for coming back because of your age, because you're younger.
Uh-huh.
Because you see what's around the room.
Uh-huh.
So a lot of the younger guys that show up, they're just kind of like, they go stir crazy. Like, I can't see. LeClaire! Sorry. Like, I can't take this. I got to get out of here. Let's go to a bar. You know, I'm like, but there's card tricks. We're learning things, you know, and but like 4 days of mind-blowing close-up magic until you just can't take it anymore. Your brain's gonna explode.
Oh yeah.
But your first convention, you slept through half of it. I know because you were on my couch.
Wait, which one?
The one in Batavia, your first 4F. I came back to the room and you were still asleep. And so you missed a lot of it. So you coming back, I was like, well, I guess he obviously got something out of it. Because he came again.
Yeah. Well, I love the shows, but for me, like I love just jamming. Like, you know, for me, it's hanging out with the magician, just having a beer, and also just building relationships. Because during the show, you could see someone's show, and it's great. But then having a conversation to see why they do their show, how do they build their, you know, like you meet the person behind the show,
right?
And that's how you build a relationship, and that's how you make friendships. You know, that last.
I think that's the best times. Yeah. That to me is the most memorable. The limoncello and all those.
So, and then there's fun adventures. Like, magicians are crazy people. Like, we all have our own reason that we got into magic. And, you know, it's always a fun, you know, different. And your convention's always different. And, yeah, and it's sometimes the card tricks you see a lot. And you sometimes can be too much. Like, I need a break from this.
Yeah.
But sure. I feel like we're just coming post pandemic where we all just want, you know, like, we haven't seen our friends in so long. Because, you know, obviously we travel around. We usually, you know, I live in LA. And all my magician friends in LA, we usually see each other more on the road. You know, we're always traveling, but now when we're all locked up, we can't see all the people we like, so.
I'm in LA now, I forgot that. Yeah. That's what, when I got here, it was that feeling of like, how many places can you go where you run into that many of your favorite people?
Oh, yeah.
And then I turn around and you're standing there, and I'm like, I didn't even know you were gonna be here. I was like, yes, I can't believe you're back, that's amazing.
Yeah.
So, the first question I usually ask my guests, because of the name of the talk show, is Something Up My Sleeve.
Mm-hmm.
What is something up your sleeve? Not necessarily, unless you have something up your sleeve, which, by the way, incredible jacket.
Thank you. You
don't need anything up your sleeve because the sleeves are amazing enough on their own.
Yeah.
But what is, metaphorically speaking, what do you bring to the table that makes somebody want to book you instead of someone else? Or why do we want to watch your performance, and what makes you unique?
I love the art form of magic. You know, a lot of younger magicians nowadays, especially with social media, they tend, I think, to abuse and use the art form. They actually don't care about magic. It's more as like, they just see as, here's a couple quick tricks, and I could get lots of views, and they don't care what they leave, you know, what wake they leave in their past. You know, so it's almost that they're taking advantage of the art form without actually caring about it. I won't name names, but some pictures are probably popping up in your minds right now. You know, where they just don't act. So for me, as a young kid, I just got hooked.
But if you want names, talk to Eric LeClaire.
But, you know, as a young kid, 6, 7, I always saw a magician perform, and I was just, you know, he would make like a little rabbit disappear in a little box. And as a kid, I was just like, whoa. And then for, you know, obviously with David Blaine's special hit, you know, you see people running around and reacting to magic. And I was like, oh, this is different. Like, for the first time, I felt like I watched real magic. Like, but by the reactions and the authenticity behind him. And then I started doing magic for people when I was 12, 13. And I was able to get those same reactions, the visceral people running out of rooms, and that's adults.
Yeah.
So I kind of got sidetracked from the question, but you know, for me, that's why I just so hooked on it.
Was that the age when, were you at that age when David Blaine was on TV? Was that a huge influence?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. But for me to get those, and for me as a younger kid, to be able to like have adult people you respected, your coach, this person, and they're running out of the room reacting, and you never seen the adult react like that in your life ever. And so for me, that's what got me hooked. So I think it's a lot my authenticity, my love for magic. A lot of people will comment, the way I react to the magic is like, I'm almost like amazed at the magic every time. And I don't fake that reaction. When the magic's happening, I'm genuinely impressed. I'm having a great time. You know, I'm enjoying myself so much. So I think that kind of hits them. They can see that I'm authentic towards my craft. And yeah, I think that's probably the number one
thing. I would agree. Authenticity.
Yeah. I'm good at it. Like I definitely put in my hours, you know?
Obviously. Yeah. and I'll add to that you have an authenticity and a humility factor that you come across as just a genuine person, that you're going to be the same character off stage as on. Mm-hmm. And most people don't really achieve that, especially, well, and sometimes on purpose when, like, you're playing characters like what you just saw me do or what you just missed that I did.
Oh, that was great.
Which is obviously a character.
I thought that's your... Never mind.
My regular shtick.
I mean, I wouldn't care if that's, you know... Like, if I was walking down the random street at a bar and I saw you like that, I wouldn't be like, hey, I wouldn't call you out if I saw you working or anything.
So, to catch you guys up, I was wearing a dress with a wig on, essentially playing a version of Lucy Darling. That I came up with a stage name. Did I tell you my stage name?
No.
Juicy Starling.
Oh, that's really good. I almost hit on you when I walked up to you.
I saw you checking me out. Yeah, I did a double take.
I did a flip, and I saw the hair, but we could get past that. You know?
I mean, that can be taken care of. And I have, it's not my first time, I guess, if you want to call it cross-dressing, because I've played many roles. For some reason, people keep giving me these roles where they're like, you would look good in a dress. So I'm like, fine, I like to play, I like to act, I'm an actor.
I've worn a dress before.
But what was funny was because you missed the whole, you have?
Not for like a humiliation ritual, but for Halloween.
Oh, well, yeah, but it's okay, Halloween doesn't count. You can wear anything for Halloween and get away with it.
I look just like my mom, though. It was a little freaky. I had nice boobs, too, though.
So you looked like your mom?
Yeah, that's what people said in the photo.
Yeah, that is. I don't know if that's what you want to go for, but...
Well, no, it just...
I mean, it depends. I don't know your mom. I haven't met your mom, so maybe that's a good thing.
Yeah, I don't know. She's very nice.
But it was interesting watching your face because you had missed... you had missed what I did. So all you're seeing is me in the hallway for no reason. And you know we're about to do this. Like, I'm telling you, like, I'm about to interview you. And you see me just wearing this, evening gown with high heels.
I guess we're taking it there tonight. That's what I
was You're like, I was coming to your room, right? Like, yeah, honey, just come up and meet me.
I live in LA, so it wouldn't, like, nothing would surprise me.
Yeah, you weren't shocked.
Ever. Like, no,
you had more of an impressed face, I think, is what it was.
I was like, yeah, one of these parties.
But wait, we got sidetracked. Oh, because we were talking about characters. Okay, so obviously when you're playing a character, it's different when you get off stage. But, your character on stage or who you are, mm-hmm. One thing I've noticed is that not only is it genuine, mm-hmm. You never appear nervous to me, ever.
Really?
I've seen you in Quebec. I've seen you on America's Got Talent. I've seen you on Fool Us. I've seen you in person. I've seen you at 4F. And if you are, you hide it well, but you don't even seem like you need to be. So do you get nervous? Because you never appear to be nervous.
Back to the, real quick to the character thing. Nervous is a... Yes and no. Like, I wouldn't say nerves. Like, I had to quickly squash the nerves thing, because when you get on these bigger and bigger stages, you can't have the shakes.
Right.
Right. You know, you have the shakes. That's your one of you. You know, your defining career moment at the window. Yeah. So, I mean, as a kid, I remember when I first did, I would get the shakes, and then over time, yeah, I started street performing, and then I would say the busking helped. The fact that they're random people, I started busking for years, and I think that really you get your leg work in.
Well, that's where you got your chops. I did not realize you.
So yeah, so when you're on the street and you're doing, you know, 5 to 8 shows a night, so every night.
Where were you doing this?
Saratoga Springs, New York.
Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
Okay.
So you get your industry. Yeah, so I did that for 4 years where you're working a lot. Yeah. So you're able to get, you know, in a weekend you get 20, 30 shows. And so that's a place to get it where you can't really get that anywhere else. That repetition.
Oh yeah.
So I think that kind of helped with the nerves. And then I started just getting these TV gigs where it happened so quickly. You know, I had the viral video with the cops. And then next morning, Good Morning America's like, come on our TV show. And that was like...
Is that what kind of started sort of your... the that fame area of like... Because even when I met you at 4F, you were already known. Like, kids that would see me do magic would ask me if I knew you.
Mm-hmm.
Before I'd actually met you.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Nice. So you had already achieved a level of fame. And mm-hmm. I was wondering what had really kicked that off. Because I didn't think it was before. I think you on America's Got Talent. You had already had some videos that went viral.
Yeah, so I did Magic for Cops, got out of the speeding ticket, and then I just started doing, and then I did Fool Us, and then the AGT. So it's like you're doing these big stages, and I never said nerves. I was just like, I feel energized, you know. And I always try not to be nerve. I mean, I try to. You want to feel something, but I always try to remain calm. As far as the character part, I try to be myself, just a little more energized, you know, a little more. Behind my I'd bring it out more because a lot of times I can be more reserved and relaxed, but yeah, no, it's right. People could tell though when I'm performing. Like I'll be around a group of friends and I'll just be talking normal, and the moment I start to perform, I sit up, engaged, and you start, you know, and then they see it just click instantly. So it's still me. It's just me. If you just, you know, added a little battery to me, a little spark.
a little Red Bull. And also, though, you made one particular effect pretty famous.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's the one, I think that's what you did on Fool Us, but mm-hmm. with the cube. And then you basically immediately shared it and marketed it. You didn't seem to be at all concerned that others would be doing your routine, whereas a lot of magicians, even if they aren't going to complain about it, they're still going to feel like, oh God, see everybody, oh, they're doing that same bit. It's covering my bit.
Well,
you know,
so
you never really had that attitude.
Well, the reason I felt that way, it was, so I started street performing, and then the first time I posted my video online of my street performance act, I had someone comment, like, your act is good enough to steal. Right away. And then right after I started doing my act, like on AGT, someone did another talent show where they copied my act verbatim. But without like using my same joke, same everything, just like copy paste. And I was like, oh, but at that point I was like, you know what? It's at a level where, and so now I teach it freely because they're gonna copy it either way. If someone wants to do it, like, they're just gonna do it. And it's at the point where I thought, you know what? I taught it more as a toolbox. So on Cube 3, the DVD that I teach, or sorry, the download that I teach, it's 6 different effects. And when I talk about it, I say, here's a bunch of facts about Rubik's Cubes. Here's 6 different effects with it. You could interchange them, you can move them around, come up with your own fun presentation. I talked to a lot of different, I do a trade show, you talk about, you know, it's mixed, finding solutions, that's, you know, a good business connection, you know, so you could link it in with however you're marketing the company. But I told them basically piece together how you want. So more of like a toolbox of here's, you know, with card slights, come up with your own routines in that sense.
Did you also have the confidence that you knew you would come up with other stuff anyway? And that you would move on from there and work on other routines, so you weren't as concerned?
Well, a lot of the stuff on Cube 3, it's either all updated or I don't do, like, it's all new stuff. So a lot of stuff I'm doing now, I don't even do this same stuff at this point. So, yeah. So I have a lot of new stuff that I'm working on, and that was also a reason when
you didn't do a performance here?
No.
Oh, that's right, you didn't have to?
No.
Oh, because yeah, I remember talking to you, like, you just get to relax.
Yeah.
How did you get out of doing an act? That's amazing. Like, who do you know?
Yeah.
I mean, just because they know what you're capable of. So I don't understand how you could circumvent that.
I was going to hang out.
I mean, if I was running the show, I would find a place like, okay, where are we putting Steven? Because we have to see
him. Supposed to be in the Friday night show, but something happened.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
that's
fine.
Okay, whatever.
Yeah, so it's like I'm always coming with new stuff that I'm always, you know, trying to work on. So a new product probably this year.
Now, the cube mixed in the bag, mm-hmm. and it matches, and I don't have the experience with Rubik's Cubes that mm-hmm. a lot of magicians know a lot about the history, so I'm mm-hmm. coming from I don't have that knowledge. Mm-hmm. Was that your idea? Is that your idea? Because you're the first person I saw do it.
No, so the cube in the bag, a lot of people have been doing cube in the bag for longer than me. I know Takamitsu Usui has done it. Carl Hein has done it. Funny stuff with Carl Hein, I started creating a lot of some Rubik's Cube stuff independently, and then he has done it for years, and then we compared our mix-ups. We actually had the same mix-ups, totally independently, but we performed it differently. Okay. So it looked completely differently, but it was the same pattern.
Also known as Copper Top. A great friend of mine as well.
Yeah, so but it was funny to see how I totally independently, I never saw his cube stuff ever, and it's like, oh, we had the same exact idea. Because you're using limited, you know, there's only so much you can do with the Rubik's Cube. But so I've had that happen a lot of times where you come up with something and someone have a similar idea or this, and a lot of the Rubik's Cube stuff I've been inspired by other magicians, but what I think I had the advantage of is I was a cuber first. So I started cubing when I was 12 and I did a separate from magic for like 10 years. So then when I started applying magic to it, I had this background where the cube was actually just a cube, it wasn't a prop. So a lot of magicians view the Rubik's Cube as a prop and not what it is. You know, because when you could actually study how the Rubik's Cube works and you get fast at just solving it, you understand a lot better than other magicians. So it allowed me to start creating magic at a pretty fast pace with it.
And it's interesting because audiences don't know if you're really using skill that where you're solving it, or if there's magic involved or sleight of hand involved that has nothing to do with the actual solving of the cube. They don't know.
It's weird with magicians have such a weird reaction. A lot of magicians don't like Rubik's Cube. They don't consider Rubik's Cube magic. I get it all. I hear it all the time where they're like, you're doing the Rubik's Cube, but why don't you do magic for your crowd? And I'm like, they're like, oh, you do the Rubik's Cube, but what about magic? Are you going to do magic for them or just the cube? And I'm just like...
It's like doing bubbles.
And I'm thinking about it for a moment. Like, well, okay, the methods I'm using, I could ring in gimmicks if I want, and I could gimmick my stuff or whatever. I could do instant, like, how is your magic and my magic? Right. Like, there's like the level of, like, I think Darwin Ortiz covers it, where it's like a trick. What are the three levels that he talks about? Puzzle.
Is it trick, puzzle, illusion? Or,
Puzzle, illusion, like the real magic idea, or like the feeling of real magic, or the feeling of, oh, it's just a trick, a feeling, oh, it's just in a puzzle. Right. You know, to get to that level, but it is just a puzzle, but you can make it feel like magic if done properly.
You're saying magic, not
you know, if you show a totally mixed cube and you shake it like this and it's solved, you hand it out, that's not a puzzle anymore. That breaks the puzzle. That's a magic.
Well, you're doing magic with a puzzle. It in itself is an actual puzzle.
Yeah, but it's weird how some magicians are like, they don't consider it magic. Like, oh, do magic. I'm like, let me see your magic. Like, what are you talking about? I don't think you're doing magic. like, what is this?
Yeah, calm down, wizard.
But some magicians say that to me, and I'm just like, and some people are adamant, like, that's not magic. Oh, the card magic is magic. And I'm like, they're just shuffling. It's the same. It's group theory, right? Set number of cards in a pattern shuffling. It's like
it's math.
They're turning it over. Oh, that sleight of hand. It's like the cubes do this sleight of hand if done right. But I'm kind of ranting at this point about these people.
No, it makes perfect sense. Okay,
I'm a little I don't know.
If I take a cube, toss it up in the air, and it vanishes, well, that's way more magical than a 21 card trick, right?
No, but the guys would say that's I don't know something.
Yeah. All right, so beyond the cube, because what actual magic? No,
right? What?
I've seen you do other things because I've seen you perform many times.
Yeah.
But what are some of your staples that, or if someone said, all right, no cubes, I want to see what else you do.
Yeah, I mean, so I started doing card magic when I was 6 or 7. So for me, like I'm a pretty adept card magician. So yeah, I mean, so I love the pasteboards. I've been doing a lot of stuff. I love slide intensive stuff. Or this is for magicians or for lay people, though?
Mostly magicians.
Yeah. So I love, you know, a good amount of stack work. I love culling cards. I like that a lot.
Cool.
You know, so I'll do lots of, you know, one of my favorite routines, I'll have, you know, everything shuffled, then I say name a number, 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 number. So you say 4, you know, 7, 6, that, and then right away we start getting the fours, and then we do lots of 4-for-4 changes. So four different 4-for-4, you know, to get all the different numbers, and there are lots of fun routines like that. So,
cool.
Yeah, switches and fun, you know, just so lots of stuff like that, but also, you know, some rope magic, money magic. Obviously, as a worker, strolling magic or stage shows.
You're on your way from here to a strolling gig.
Yeah.
So, what are some of your go tos for strolling? Because we've been mainly talking about, or I've been mainly talking about stage. Yeah. But what are some of your go-tos when you're going to be doing your walk around?
Yeah, so I love, I mean, obviously the Rubik's Cube's a staple. My torn effect, my torn card to Rubik's Cube.
Oh, I don't know that one.
Yeah, so I do ripped off corner to Rubik's Cube.
Okay.
And was, yeah.
So the effect is
so that. So pick any card you want, and then you rip off the corner, disappear, it's inside the Rubik's
Cube. Oh, it's inside? How do you, yeah. You open the cube?
Yeah, it's right inside there. Wow. And it's nice because it's repeatable. You just do it over and over and over again. So you could stroll to as many tables as you want, and you just do the effect over and over and over.
That's I haven't seen that.
Yeah. So that's a nice one because it packs a punch.
Puzzling.
Yeah.
Did I tell you about when I pulled Carl Hein on stage?
Mm-hmm.
As I had a show, he happened to be in New Orleans. He wanted to come watch the show. I was like, okay, you know, I didn't even know what I was going to do tonight. So mm-hmm. Guess what? You're in the show. This is amazing because I played one of my characters who's kind of an idiot, Cousin Cajun Mike.
Mm.
So it's a whole character that would not have the skill to solve a Rubik's Cube. And I asked the crowd, can any of y'all solve a Rubik's Cube? Raise your hand if you can solve a Rubik's Cube. And so here's Carl, just looking like this casual. And he doesn't look like a magician, right? Especially if he's just in casual clothes.
I mean, if he wears his top hat.
No, but he's not.
He's fedora.
Dressed in jeans.
Yeah.
And he's like, yeah, I can do it. And I was like, how quick can you do it? Like, what, 5 minutes? He's like, less than a minute. And the crowd goes, ooh, they have no idea. And this is, they have no idea that this is the routine I planned, is I'm just going to spotlight him. And I bring him up and challenge him. And we do a switch along the way so that nobody sees it coming. And then he ends with like tossing it behind his back. They don't know what to think because they think I just pulled this guy.
What is this?
So it's like one of those routines I'd probably never be able to do again unless he happens to be there. But it was brilliant. I have it all on video. Yeah,
that's great.
It was cool. And he's what you and him are some like two of my favorite Rubik's guys that are just amazing.
We've created a really good relationship. What's funny is my friend Sean Pop. So you know Sean Pop? So I was at Magic Fest and he showed me one of Carl's routines and I was like, oh wow. So he then got me in touch with Carl through email. And then since then, me, Sean, and Carl, we've gone skiing together. We travel around. We've hung out quite a bit and become good friends. So
nice.
Yeah, our cube gang.
Now, one thing we were talking about earlier that I think is interesting, and I love this perspective. You have some great perspectives, especially for someone like so young, because he's young. I mean, you're young.
Thank you.
Compared to me, you're young.
I don't know how old you are.
You're young. Okay. So, but the whole social media perspective of like, because I was talking about the TikTok, and you're like, well, I'm not really a TikToker. I'm a magician.
Yeah.
And that your goal is, I want to perform. I want to do magic. I'm not an influencer, a content creator. Yes, I've created content out of what I do.
Mm.
But that's not my focus. So I want you to talk a little bit more about that because I love that perspective and the fact that you have your mindset properly on what it is you're trying to achieve,
mm-hmm.
And the difference is there.
Yeah, I mean I think obviously as a magician, you look at like the musicians, they become these mega stars, all this money. Magic is not really glamorous. Like there's not many a ton of magicians crushing it. There's some that you could do very
nobody's
well.
Nobody's throwing their panties on stage.
You could do very well as a magician, but you're gonna have to work, and it's nothing's really guaranteed. But it's one of the things where I forget who posted on Facebook, but someone said like, be proud of being a magician. You know, be proud of the fact that I think.
Well, it's a very unique skill. Very unique.
Yeah, and also I think there's so many magicians. If you're in, if you respect the art form, you're in the proper lineage. The fact that there's so much credit given. To the giants of the show which we stand on, the fact that everyone credits, oh, this person taught me this and this, and it's such a brotherhood and community. So I think that aspect of magic is so something to be proud of magicians, which I'm really proud of being a magician. So I bring that towards creating, and while, you know, I think I'm definitely am a creator. You're so much more than just one thing. I think that's one of the issues I've been battling with is sometimes you get boxed in or being labeled, and then trying to, sometimes people appreciate the label, oh, you're great, this is amazing, but sometimes like, we're so much more than just that one thing. So I think, but yeah, so I mean, what was the question you said?
Well, the difference between being an influencer and being a magician,
yeah.
and how do you differentiate the two, or how can the two benefit each other without switching gears completely?
Yeah, well, they're just labels and titles. When I say influencer, you think of like the more like, oh, I'm gonna be a YouTuber and this, and just like,
right.
Just endless amount of content and this, and then a lot of times it happens where you start caring about the content, then all of a sudden the algorithm starts getting taken hold of it, and you have to,
yeah.
Get the numbers and the views. And I've always been lucky where I'll post, and if it does well, it does well, but if it doesn't do well, I don't really care. As long as you're making the content that you want to make and you're enjoying it, that's all that matters.
Well, and we know people who aren't really concerned with how good their magic is. They're concerned with, will this make a good TikTok video, but can't really hold their own at a walk around gig.
But even if they just post the shittiest, well, a lot of times they'll post and expose the magic. Like, so much of it is they expose the magic. So the idea is I'm going to be performing here as I'm exposing the thing, and then all of a sudden, just for the views and this, and it feels a little bit like...
Right.
And so there's so many magicians who have like 10 million followers, tons of them, who just do crappy magic online, which is... The thing is, they don't show their face at these conventions. They don't really, like, come around certain groups of people because they're not going to be respected.
It's easy to get blackballed from the community when you're basically tearing apart an art form that we love, like... taking a beautiful painting and then setting fire to it because, this is gonna get hits, this is gonna get views, look at this fire. Well, yeah, but you just ruined this painting.
Yeah, but then some magicians do push the envelope. Like when Penn and Teller did their clear cups and balls, I think it was done in a way where it's like, some people are mad, but people really don't, like people aren't really that intense about the method. Like people don't realize, like people don't remember how things are done.
Yeah, it's a lot
it's
about
so much
retention.
On information overload. Things, how many videos pop up on someone scrolling through the stuff. Unless
like,
they're,
what is the retention?
If they really want to find out the secret, they're going to find out. But most people don't care about magic the way that we do, in that sense. But yeah, no, it's an interesting balance where everything you see that sometimes it has things have to evolve and change sometimes. But then again, it's always about that balance, you know.
So two more questions. One, what is your takeaway from being at this prestigious close-up convention known as 4F, your second time here? What would be your takeaway of this convention? Besides seeing me in a dress,
that's kind of fun. The gala show was really nice tonight. I had really fun watching that.
Any particular moment that hit you?
Chris Capehart was great. His stage presence was, you know, fantastic to see.
How about those effects? Do you have any idea? Two effects that I honestly don't know was the light bulb and then the piece of paper that just falls over on its own.
He's a force user.
He's the Jedi.
Yeah.
So that's the secret.
I thought you. Yeah. But
not that I wanted you to reveal. I was just wondering, did you have any idea? Because I'm sitting there.
I have a few ideas.
We're looking at each other like me and John Allen and Jeff Williams looking at each other. We kept doing this.
Yeah. Sounds
over
right.
And over. I'm like, come on. Like he does mainly. I know him as doing a lot of kid show stuff, and he's fooling everybody. I'm like looking around the room, like don't pretend like you know because you don't know.
He's good. Yeah.
Like, don't pretend like you know. We don't know, so you don't know. Yeah.
But so besides the shows,
it's so quick and visual. It's just like that's pretty magic.
I'm trying to think. A lot of people did cube stuff. I'm very critical of cube magic.
I'm sure.
So I'll say it was okay. It was good. Some was good. Some was okay.
Was there cube tonight, or did I miss it?
It was a little bit of cube. It was not really cube. It was more just like...
Yeah,
but I mean, I'm pretty critical, and there's stuff I liked about it, stuff that I think could be improved.
And William Watt's routine, unfortunately, I had to watch from the side because I was emceeing that particular show, so I didn't really get the whole visual impact of it had on the audience, but I loved his energy.
His energy. He had lots of... It's fun when you see someone take their unique spin. Like, he's someone where it's like, with the teaching...
Yeah.
Here's a toolbox. You know, he's doing so many different things where it's like his act is not like other Rubik's Cube magicians.
Yeah.
So it's nice to see, even though the effects might be similar, it's all the subtleties that really separate the performers. Another really big takeaway, I met a lot of new people that I haven't connected with. So, you know, after being around 4F and you see people that you might talk to and like you kind of know them by face, but then I had a lot of deeper conversations with some of these people and hung out with them. So it was cool to, you know, deepen some relationships. And have a good time. So
beautiful.
Yeah.
All right, last question, and then I'm gonna let you get because I know you gotta get on the road. You
8-hour drive.
8-hour drive.
Drink some Red Bull late at night.
So you've had some great, that's your water. You've had some unbelievable accomplishments early in life. You've had some great achievements. Some things that are coveted by many that other magicians would love to have achieved. What's next, and what do you see having done all that? What do you see for yourself, or what's in the plans for what you want to hit?
Yeah, I mean, for me, I love the aspect of just performing for real people. So during the pandemic, I didn't really do the Zoom virtual stuff. I had a lot of shows lined up that year. Like it was probably my busiest year in the last 4 years.
Yeah.
So it went to zero, but that was a really nice, I think, a valuable lesson more than anything else to see your income drop to zero in one day. You know, and a lot of people went through really tough. I had a really difficult time during the pandemic. It was a really dark time for me.
It really was. Okay. Oh, see, I can't see that. So, you don't. You seem always so positive and energetic and happy that I feel like you wouldn't even have that side. That's interesting to me.
Yeah,
that
it was a lot. It was like some just bad shit happened. You know, like things. It was like three or four things just piled on each other and just led me in a really dark place.
And I guess for performers, when you don't have an outlet, of performing in some fashion.
Yeah.
Then it really gets to
it. And it was a lot more than just before. It was like, you know, family issues and this, and something happened with, you know, like, just not good stuff. And then, so I had a really difficult time. So getting out of that, it was almost like you just having a new life again. So now I'm just very grateful more than anything else. For me, I'm just grateful to be here. I'm appreciating every moment I have. So for me, just getting back on the road, just doing my shows, you know, getting a nice, feeling confident about my show, you know. And I did a couple of halftime shows last year, so I did a couple of NBA halftime shows, and that's fun because you're doing 15,000 people in the round.
Wow.
And the round is always difficult.
Yeah.
And it's a really challenging show because college shows are fun, but to have that many people and you only get 7 minutes. So that was a really fun challenge. So I think I might try to do more halftime shows.
So you enjoyed that. Oh,
yeah.
That is a huge challenge.
And then also probably, you know, just build the channel up. Like I maybe like focus more on the YouTube aspect and maybe like blow up and get, you know, gain followers and do that stuff, but do it with my ethics behind it. You know, I really be proud of the content I post and also not care what other people think too. Because I've been pretty, you know, knowing at this point, if you have to support a family, you have to support a family, you know,
right.
And if you're happy with your content, other people could bitch and moan at you in the magic community, but they're not paying your bills either.
Right.
You know,
right.
So a lot of people get upset at some of these performers who are, oh, they do stupid videos on this, but it's like, it's just a stupid video. You don't respect them as a magician. But I don't like that content for me personally, but I wouldn't mind posting, whether it's like starting a podcast or doing different things like that. I think I would just want to venture more into that creativity aspect of it.
Are you going to be back in Los Angeles in June?
Yes.
Cool.
Yeah,
I'm moving through 18th?
Yeah.
So you can come see me at my first time in the Magic Castle.
I'm actually moving to Santa Monica. I'm getting a new spot.
Oh, wow. So we can hang out.
Oh, yeah.
I'll be there with Meadow Perry and with Oscar Munoz.
I love Oscar.
We will be working the stage together.
I'll invite some friends. We'll hang out.
I love it. That's awesome. All right.
Yeah.
So come to California and hang out with us. And you can meet Steven Brundage. We're going to go hang in the Magic Castle next month. But this has been an amazing something up my sleeve. Thank you very much for a very informative interview. And
thank you,
please,
man.
Be careful on the road.
I will do.
Hey, guys. This is Steven Brundage. This is solving 7 Rubik's Cubes in 1 minute with magic.
The world's greatest magicians, like this next act.
Hi, I'm Shiro Ogawa. I'm from Japan. The most important thing magic has taught me is how to be a better person. I was a nerd in school, and I thought magic would make me popular. But when my trick was done, people would just walk away. Then I realized that it wasn't about me, it's about the audience and their experience. Of course, good magic is very important, but it doesn't matter if the audience isn't happy. I learned magic in a very unusual way. Instead of studying just tricks, I studied how people feel happy and comfortable. It's still the focus of my magic today.
A very special episode because we are on location at the most prestigious close-up magic convention basically in the world, the 4F Magic Convention, which is happening in Buffalo, New York. And I'm very honored to have someone that I've been a fan of for years, who is a master of this craft, Shoot Ogawa, is here with me to be my guest on Something Up My Sleeve. So we're going to talk a little bit about 4F and what this convention is about. But my first question to my guest is always, because of my title, what is something up your sleeve? Not literally, unless you do have something in your sleeve, but meaning, what do you bring to the table that makes you special as a performer, that makes you unique?
I actually do not know that much. Well, I do magic fine, and you know, I communicate with people fine. I don't know, but it's my gonna connect of who I want to be from when I was young to the now. So basically, I didn't want to be the number one or like, you know, the shiny guy. I just wanted to have friends around. Then I spent like 37, 8 years to the magic, learning magic, and I tried to be better man. And at the end, my goal is basically, if I'm here, you don't know why, but you know, somehow this moment is fun. But you know, nobody don't give me credit, but somehow they recognize if Shoot is here, somehow this moment is so great and enjoyable and very peaceful. Feel happy. Sometimes some other people are gonna get more attention, but somehow this moment's great. So I wanna be the guy who create the moment, but I don't want to have a spotlight sometimes. You know, I don't have to have a spotlight. So, and then somehow my clients, audience, or for example, magician friends, whoever see me, they're somehow happy. I'm trying to be there, but you know, it's 4F. So like a Sean, for example, or like a Gene Anderson, you know, everybody choose him because he makes whole situation nicer, right?
He has a $1 million smile.
Yeah, like we don't need answer, just he's there and then he has value. And right. then I wanna be like that guy. Maybe I'm gonna need maybe another 20 side years, or maybe 40 years. Maybe someday I don't achieve and I'm gonna die. But still, like, you know, I wanna be that kind of guy. But if I wanna be that kind of guy, also still I need a good skill set, good magician, like a good, I need to be a good performer. If I don't have value, of course they don't see me as valuable, but you know, but at the end they recognize somehow when his shoot is there, this event was successful. Somehow when he's there, everybody was so happy at the end. So that's like my goal. And also probably I'm kind of getting something, almost, I'm 48 now. So like, you know, I'm kind of getting something. So, but I don't know,
we're close to the same age, but for some reason, I seem to look more that age. I don't know what it is.
I'm so jealous, actually. Like, you know, I have actually gray hair, but like, I'm trying to hide. But yeah, like, right.
Illusion.
You know, like, I tried to do once, and my wife so got mad because it didn't match. So.
Oh right.
So anyway, yeah.
But it works for you. No, but you have a young look, and I think a lot of people probably don't realize how much experience you have until they see your performance. And we're going to come back to, I want to ask you more questions about 4F, but I'm going to jump to, because to help you answer my first question, I want to jump to Fool Us, because I feel like your performance was extremely unique because of the reaction that it had on Penn & Teller, and not just them, but everyone. I mean, I don't think there's many Fool Us performances that have made people cry, including myself. And that element of magic is what you bring to the table. And what is behind that? How do we spotlight your hands that it makes it that moving for someone like Teller, someone with that much experience?
I don't know how to explain, but the situation was very unique. It was the middle of a pandemic for the shooting.
That's right.
Yeah.
Right.
So and on big studio, after the editing, many faces on the screen on the back of the Penn and Teller, but actually only Penn, Teller, Allison, MC. And I was behind curtain, and they don't know the name because it's, you know, kind of Nevada law. It's
right.
A kind of gong show. They cannot know the performer's name before
right.
They come out.
Yeah, because they expectations.
Yeah.
Or, yeah,
and then, you know, like it was like 7 or 8 or 9 seasons. So like, you know, I want to be there, but I never made it. But they know me like last 10, 15 years for sure.
Right.
So, and I just want to start to read. How to read it? Is this Ogawa or Ogawa? And then Penn & Teller look back. You got Shoot here, so they recognize it. It means to me a lot because I didn't think they're gonna say that, like, oh, you got a good one today, right? And I come out and Teller was sitting, and I just shake hand. Oh, you are here, very gently. You're here, and I say, yes, I'm finally here. Just a 30 second, and camera rolling, right? We don't have a conversation. So, and I had a mini script, like, you know, producer asked me, maybe you can say this or this or this, and I put away everything away, and then just I
spoke from my heart, and I did cut it off a little bit, but like, you know, I said I love magic and I care magic. That's why I'm here, and that's you're here. So, and then, you know, just I will show you. Then I just showed what I practiced like last 15, 20 years. Then, you know, we sometimes in a season, it's a great example. When I was seeing other performer, I was crying all the time because I can feel the passion. And, you know, on the competition, jury is doing hard work. They put number on it, but actually, you know, they know these people really made effort whole life almost to be there, right? And we can feel like everybody have some bit, right? So then I, you know, everybody was approaching, standing every single time. And it was a great time. And, you know, we know if we make effort, we know how much it's making effort. Even some comedy magician, I can tell this guy failed so many, many times and making moments so fun. So, and when we feel it, we kind of see as mirror, and then sometimes we have a tear. So, and I think Tera made best effort more than anybody from my perspective. So he appreciate not just me, like any performer who's being there and showing them like best craft, then they recognize, doesn't matter if they know or not. So that's why, like, you know, I really feel like, you know, these days I try to talk from my heart as much as I can, and try to engage with people, whoever involved for the situation, including the tech guys or like, you know, stagehand or whoever who's in the venue. Can be 100, can be 200, can be only 4. But like, you know.
Well, Teller's face while watching you was the face of someone who truly admires magic and truly was witnessing how magic is meant to be done. And that, I think that's basically what Penn was trying to express to you during that moment. And that choice of what you did, I want to come to that, of like, how did you decide what you would do on that show? And also, was part of that, I saw you in Quebec, in FISM, and was part of that, did that lead up to the FISM Act? So, because I saw that full, which was longer, how did you come to those choices of what you were going to perform in those moments?
Basically, I wanted to go to FUAS at the time, and I talked to Simon Cornell, and, you know, he's my best buddy, and, you know, like, I talked to a couple more people, like, who I really trust. Like, my trust means, like, who doesn't have to be same skill
level. Simon, who took the first place, is that
right? Yeah, the Grand Prix.
Who did the ring.
Oh,
my gosh.
So, and we convinced each other and competed with him. Actually, we were talking right before the deadline, actually. But I shouldn't expose too much. But, you know, it's kind of a funny story. But anyway, so Simon, I asked Simon, okay, if I want to be on the FUAS, not trying to fool them, just going to be on FUAS to meet them, seeing them in pandemic, what should I do? And he said, Ninja Rings, Pass Frame Routine, or Painting Act. Three major things. And, you know, I'm asking, I do not trust my judgment. I trust my friend's judgment. And then, but not 100%, I aware why they say so, of course. But, you know, he's a smart guy. So, you know, when he says so, probably, let me try. And I sent 3 video of the 3 acts.
Oh, you sent all 3?
All 3, yes.
Oh, wow, okay.
Then, you know, they took Pass Frame.
Most people have trouble coming up with one routine. You had 3 to offer.
Yeah, it was lucky. So I had a choice, and even I didn't know it's going to be good or not. So, but I got, okay, if you say so, I videotaped, and I showed, you know, Simon and the other friend, and it's going to be okay. He said, yeah, just send it. And send it, and then they said, okay, we're going to take the Pass Frame routine. So I said, okay, I'm doing this a long time. I'm sure they're going to recognize, but, you know.
I think that's, for me, my favorite. I absolutely love the whole idea behind the purse frame and having an invisible person producing objects out of nothing. But I think initially, at least, because now I believe you're famous for a lot of different things, including coins and the purse frame, but the Ninja Rings, for a long time, I think that's how people associated your name because of how smooth those rings were. Can you talk a little bit about that process?
The Ninja Rings?
Yes.
Ninja Rings, every routine is I'm not taking whole credit. Obviously, like, I didn't create the linking ring, and also I studied from my mentor at the time. So it is a routine. Routine is a unique combination, but also structure. So these days I feel like the linking ring routine is including a lot of skills, unique skills. But the basic idea of the Ninja Rings routine, or I call it the linking ring now, is never juggling go over the magic. Some people throw rings in the air, they can hit in the air and link, but it is juggling is more than magic.
Right.
So, and my spinning, for example, on the table and touch, it's really extremely skillful, but magic is stronger. Like we cannot believe what happens there, right? So I keep this is a basic rule. Every single technique must be magic stronger than
that's,
juggling.
That's interesting.
Yeah, very and interesting. It'll keep that it as magic.
Right.
Otherwise, we're
sure.
gonna be juggler,
sure.
and bad juggler, pretty much. So and then after that, like Linking Wing, I'm almost getting there. I hope people can come over to see, you know, what I do in Hawaii right now. I'm in Hilton Hotel, Hilton Waikiki Beach Hotel.
Oh.
I'm doing 70-minute show, and including
that's where you're performing now.
Yeah, I'm doing that like already.
Oh, excellent!
10 months.
I did not realize that.
So
okay.
and including Linking Wing, it's theater itself is 60 seat, and I'm performing for the live audience. No camera projector, so I of course move around a little bit. But
how long have you been there?
10 months.
Oh wow!
Yeah.
Okay.
So and I'm almost feeling like getting there. So Linking Wing, great for the lay people, and great for the magicians. And I can, I feel like, you know, only 3-4 minutes of act, but I feel like I'm having one kind of a journey together. So almost like studying yoga. Yoga is like a basically the, you know, fun structure of sometimes routine, but every day is different. Sometimes we feel stiff, sometimes we feel like flexible, more energized, and then every day we have to feel, right?
Right.
When I take the rings out from bag, I already know something different from yesterday, and I start to do it. And then, you know, the audience is also different. So we feel it, right? So you're a really good performer, so you feel audience, and you have to have a right answer without thinking almost, right? So it's coming from experience. I'm doing rings like 37 years, right? So I know, I know it's gonna work for sure, but someday, you know, it's not easy, someday easy. So, but I feel audience, I manage your people's eyes, and at the end, everybody almost like focus, and then reduce and laugh all together. And then at the end, I recognize when I do this, actually, we all link together. And then, wow, it's valuable. And everybody says, oh, yes, that's right. So they kind of recognize something. I have something I want to tell to the people. But every time, slightly different, because people is different, I
sure.
feel different. So, but skill is just foundation, as you know. Like a skill, gimmick, anything is like, you know, just a tool for us. But if we have something to tell to the people, they feel kindness sometimes. They feel like some energy. Sometimes people feel like passion. And they appreciate sometimes. So, but Ninja Rings is so fixed, routine doesn't go far away. Always like pretty much the same routine, which means that I have to feel audience and I have to recognize what I want to give at the end of this trick. So then, you know, I'm gonna guide them. So that's like a Ninja Ring routine. Skill itself is a, you know.
So when I think of Ninja Rings, my first experience with something smaller than the traditional size linking rings that most people throughout history have used, seeing you, it was at a convention years and years ago with the smaller rings. That was my first experience with that size, and then seeing how magical that looked. Where did that come from, the idea of using the smaller rings and the more focused movements?
Well, small linking ring was already popular in Asia, including Japan. So when I studied magic, it was already sellable products from Tenyo. And then, you know, my mentor was already working at the Tenyo dealer. So I purchased rings and, you know, I studied from him. So they're also like, you know, definition of small is like compared to the large.
Right.
So which means like, you know, that this ring is large or small. From some they mentioned, oh, it's so small, right? Should be this size, right? So and this one,
sure.
Okay. We call pocket ring sometimes because it fits for the pocket. So, okay.
Was that the idea of taking what essentially was a stage illusion and being able to perform it close up? Was that why they
I don't know. I didn't create the small ring. So, like, you know, someone created small ring. Or even I would say, because, you know, before Max Maven passed away, he told me that linking ring exists 500 years ago at least, because someone explained this on the paper at the time, 500
wow.
years ago. Which means that someone wrote it, means that it should be longer than that. And also, that someone had maybe budget, or someone had you know, thought about maybe I should have smaller. So who's gonna take credit? Like linking ring
sure.
and taking credit is a stupid idea in the world.
Well, it's even the name of the magazine of the International Brotherhood of Magicians. It's been called the linking ring forever,
yeah.
and it's sort of symbolic as
yeah.
to how we consider our magic and our secrets,
mm-hmm.
and how the brotherhood kind of interconnects. But for me personally, when I first saw you doing that, it was another level for me. Like I had seen linking rings, I'd seen them on stage, and of course it's such a magical illusion, but seeing it right in front of me and so smoothly done, whether it was fast or super slow, was taking it to another level for me personally.
Thank you.
I'll share another experience you probably don't even remember.
Okay.
When I saw you lecture.
Okay.
This was in Louisiana.
Okay.
We were lucky to have you come in at we used to meet at this farmhouse out in north of Lafayette.
Okay.
And we brought you in there for the Lafayette Club. I don't know if you remember.
I remember Louisiana, but like, you know, I don't remember exact picture of the venue. But I know, like, I remember I went to Louisiana because only I.
Did we bring you on a hayride? There was a hayride. Did we bring you on the hayride? No.
I don't know. I don't know.
Because we would do a hayride every time, but maybe you didn't get to go on the hayride.
What is a hayride?
What is it? Okay, you didn't do the hayride.
Okay.
It's where you get on the back of a trailer and we bring
back
you out
to the
trailer. Yeah, we
back
drive you
trailer?
With a tractor. There's a tractor with a trailer and there's hay on the trailer.
Oh, okay.
And everybody sits on the back and then we just drive around the field.
Okay, probably I never did that.
So we didn't bring you on
like
the hayride. Okay,
like
you didn't get the full experience.
Okay.
But I remember thinking at that, I remember certain moments in my history of magic, and one of those was the ingenuity that you came up with. And we don't have to get into the where, the why, or the reason, or you know, get into details as to like revealing anything, but you'll know what I'm talking about when I say I was blown away about the fact that you tied your belt to the side.
Okay.
Yeah. And, right. you showed us all how your belt was actually buckled here instead of in front.
Okay.
And that for me was just a mind-blowing moment of, wow, that's amazing.
I never thought that I'm gonna get credit for that. Just, you know.
Oh yeah, well I had never seen that. And it was just, even if I didn't want to do the routine, even if I wasn't gonna do the coin routine you were doing, I just wanted to wear my belt that way just to be different.
Just no, to be like, it was no
I'm
fashion.
Cool
it
like
Shudo Gawa.
I buckle my belt over here on the side.
It was a secret. Just I didn't want to have like a, you know, when I steal jumbo coin or anything, I don't want to have sounds from here. So that's why, you know, I still do, you know.
But it seems like nobody had thought of that. Like, it's like to me, I was like, why didn't I think of that? Why didn't anybody show me this? And it's like, because we get so used to these normal routines that sometimes you don't think out of the box and go like, oh, you know what? It would make less noise if I just moved my belt over. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so for me, that was just this moment in my head of the history of knowing you that was just brilliant to me, which I know for you was just like this probably throwaway.
Yeah.
But for me, it was this brilliant moment.
Wow, that's a very interesting. I never thought about
that. Yeah, you didn't know I was going to hit you with that
know,
one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow.
You're like, hey, remember the hayride when you turn your belt to the side? You're like, sure. Okay, great. So let's talk a little bit about you. You're performing in Hawaii on a regular basis.
Yes.
What led you to that, or what is your history on a professional level of what you do with magic? And have you done other things professionally, or it's been just magic for a while?
Just magic for whole life, except when I got fired from my same mentor 5 times. You know, always I got different job. Like when I was a teenager, so I was a bad student. So I was a bad student, but employed, like no really moral kids and like no respecting others and like I know. But I did magic. I loved magic from that time. But
you were
like,
a rebel.
What?
A rebel. You were a troublemaker.
Sure. Yeah. Probably. I don't know. Yeah.
We're getting the real shoot.
Not like I'm making trouble for the other people, but like, you know, and I was not really patient so much probably. So you know, I when I got fired several times, like, you know, when I was 19 or 20, I got fired and you know, I couldn't go back to the company and the magic you know, production company or whatever. Basically, these are like people who starting from same mentor. But I was out, so I did some work for the construction company or some of, you know, other, you know, work, but only a few times. But I'm pretty much whole life I'm doing magic.
And so why magic? Why such a unique and interesting craft?
Yeah, almost like a why equal, like, you know, sometimes what is magic? Well, like, you know, some people ask same question, what is magic for you? And it's, if what is magic for me, people can answer, but what is magic? It's really hard to answer, right?
Right.
So, and why magic? But one thing what I know is, you know, I usually say magic is, like, you know, do you know like a, two person tied up their legs and walk, like three legs, but four.
Right,
this is like, we have to walk together, right? So I'm tied up with magic.
Yeah.
And we have to walk together. And we are walking toward to the somewhere where, who, like, you know, I am not achieving yet, but I wanna be someone who I wanna be, which I'm not clearly seeing, but almost there, I feel like, but always far away. So, and I'm walking to there, but if without magic, I can walk to there. So magic is, you know, the person who is working with me. So
that's a really interesting analogy. I've never heard it put like that.
Yeah, so like also
a three-legged race.
Yeah, and magic is like a martial arts for me sometimes. Yeah. So magic is powerful, and magic sometimes hurts someone, make people scared, make people uncomfortable, make people angry, and sometimes makes people happy, sometimes makes people safe. And magic is very powerful too, I feel like martial arts. And when we get better level, we always have some painful experience because we have to against something and we fail. That's why we get better, right? So when we get some level, we actually had a many failure. It's very healthy because without failure, almost you are taking gun and shooting something, so you don't feel other side of feeling. But if you are studying martial arts, you always feel pain, and also we have to respect more and more. We recognize it's very dangerous to treat this martial arts technique. So once we get there, we become very humble, respecting other, but you know, aware of everything, and make sure when we use it or when we don't use it, we decide and we commit. So that's like same as magic. Magic is like, you know, something like that. So sometimes, you know, you already know, and like sometimes one trick makes everybody happy once in a few seconds, right? So sometimes you recognize, oh, I need to do many because, you know, I have to kind of handle a situation. Sometimes you feel like, you know what, I shouldn't do that. So this is a great decision, right? Almost like, you know, the martial arts, if you don't have to use it, it's sometimes beautiful.
Right.
So, but
no be there, like they say in the new Cobra Kai. That's the line in the new Cobra Kai. He goes, no be there.
Oh, that's interesting.
Yeah, yeah.
That's very interesting.
Avoiding the fight completely.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. This is like, you know, but good thing is that magic makes people curious. But again, I always say magic is like a samurai sword. Do you know samurai sword? Everyone, if someone knows about samurai sword, who wants to own this? It's beautiful art, right? It's in a glass case in the museum. Sometimes short sword, light sword, like a carve is different, but a sword is like power, like magic. But if you are taking sword and walking on the street, people scared you.
Sure.
Right,
I do that in New Orleans actually. I have to walk late at night. Yeah. I have. No, I'm not kidding. I carry a samurai sword because I figure, who is crazy enough to mess with me right now? Because who's gonna walk up and mess with somebody carrying a sword?
Yeah.
And so if I have to walk to my car late at night, I'm like, yeah, I'm just gonna carry my sword with me.
Yeah.
And like, because now if they do mess with me, I know I'm dealing with crazy. Like, this is on another level. Because yeah, this guy is crazy enough to mess with somebody who's already holding a sword.
Yeah.
I'm sorry,
But also, like, you know, that sometimes sword is going to make some people motivate to attack you as well. Then again, it's a crazier
to
level.
Challenge you.
Yes. So, and like a good martial artist wear dogi and try to, like, you know, learn. But a really good master wear normal clothes and pretend no one.
Right.
And when they need it, they have it inside, right?
Yes.
So they don't have to show, right? So that's like, you know, the master level. So, and magic is like a sword is like a power of magic. So everybody want to own, everybody want to have. But early time, they forget the she's has to be exist. She's is a person, personality, your kindness, respectful attitude. It is both together and it become beautiful art. Without glass case, without she's, it is no beautiful art. It's a, just a killing tool. So that's why, like, we have to have a sheath with the personality, sword as the skill set of magic, including like a gimmick skill, anything you want. But like, basically, you have to have everything inside of you, and you have a really clear judgment. Otherwise, you're gonna make people fear, or some people gonna react to attack you because they have fear, right?
Right.
So that's why, like, we have to have sheath, which is like in the your looks, but also that your attitude, clothing, everything. So.
So I take it you have experience in martial, like, that's part of your history?
I studied martial arts a little bit, but if I say so, it's risky, so I don't say that, basically.
Right, sure.
So
yeah,
I studied
right.
A little bit, but like, you know, the...
keep it sheathed.
Sheath is, but I, you know, like, magic is a sheath, so I studied magic, and I had many mistakes, and I had many problems, and I, you know, I got fired 5-6 times, more than anybody in my company at the time. And then, you know, I came to the States because, you know, I got trouble in Japan. And my mentor said, like, you go States, you know, you are not going to stay in
so
the company.
So you are a troublemaker.
Sort of. Yeah.
I didn't know that. You came to the States because you got in trouble in Japan.
I got trouble, yeah, I got trouble
wow.
in Japan. And, you know, but, yeah. Same time, like, a language barrier and that trouble had to make me more straight and honest. And otherwise, I couldn't survive in the States. So, and I always, in the show, I start to say this last couple of months, but, like, you know, language barrier is beautiful because if you see me, if you don't know, I'm a magician on the street, some Japanese tourists get in trouble, almost get in trouble. You look at me and you say, are you okay, right? And then I don't understand, are you okay? And you look around, shit, I have to help this guy. Are you okay? So coming over, right? So basically, like, when we have language barrier, you step in one more step if you recognize who is in trouble. You become nicest. Actually, you're nice, but you're hiding. But when you see some language barrier or trouble, it means that people's weakness or handicap or some of you know, like a problem is actually, everybody have a problem, right? So it's actually a nice part as well. So example, if I drink alcohol, my magic trick sucks. But people like me more. Do you know, like, this is a beautiful balance? Like, and people like, oh, you're a human being, okay, I didn't know. And like, this is the same thing, like, you know, the weakness is beautiful, right? So that's why, like, when I came to the States, I didn't speak English, I didn't know anybody, I only had the magic. When people ask me, could you just show me? I have no ego chat. Yeah, of course I show you, because otherwise I cannot survive, right? So, and I try to be nice, I try to smile. My body language become more straightforward, and Japanese people don't show reaction, but like, no, I show more because I had to survive. And I made best friends at the time, and they're still best friends. So that's the, like, you know, the way to go. So that's what I like, you know, you know.
And speaking of alcohol, I was gonna bring up a line that I've stolen from you that I use, but I quote you all the time.
Okay.
And I say, one of my favorite magicians, Shurogawa, because you're the first one I heard say this. I don't know if you came up with it, but it's
okay.
A great line, that magic is a lot like alcohol. It makes people happy and confused.
That's, yeah, I use it for the rope trick.
Sometimes,
yes,
yeah.
Make people happy and confused. Sounds like a, yeah.
That's a great line. Yeah,
yeah,
especially, you know, living in New Orleans where I live. I use that all the time.
Yeah, yeah, and people laugh as well. And people are going, ah, that's why I like it, right? So,
yeah, exactly. Yeah, it gives them the freedom to like it.
Yeah.
So last question.
Yes.
We'll talk about this particular convention, the prestigious convention.
Yeah.
I want to talk about two questions, because I want to talk about what you're doing next, because that's interesting too. But how many 4Fs have you been to? How many of these?
I think like six times. Five or six times.
Okay.
Yeah, I think so. Or six. I never really checked the year, but I came here more than four or five times. For sure, this is maybe five or six.
See, I would have guessed it's even more than that.
Yeah.
And what is your takeaway, or what keeps you coming back, and what is your takeaway from this convention?
I think. Everybody loves magic, like 100%, right? Like,
right,
you know,
yeah,
like a, no, like a 97 and 3,
right?
Like,
yeah,
it's a, and then also everybody dedicated for magic, and, you know, spending time and effort to learn something about magic. In the magic is so global, so I cannot say which kind, but, like, you know, so, and we have common knowledge and interest. So, and often I see friends, but I don't know who is gonna be here in Hawaii, but I am sure that my friend's gonna be here.
Right.
So, and I don't have to know that who is a guest, because I'm sure my friend's gonna be there.
People with a common love, people that are just as crazy as you,
yeah,
have such a love and
same
dedication.
Passion.
To
yeah,
yes.
That's why, like, 4F is so special, you know.
It is.
Big conventions everywhere, not everywhere, like, you know, for the Blackpool, FISM, and, like, there's a great conventions, of course, and Magic Live is beautiful, but, you know, only a few hundred, 200 few,
right?
And then these people have really having passion, same as me. And, like, you know, when we have a common interest for some art, you know, we can talk forever.
Right.
And then this 4F convention give us time and place. So that's
which
why
I could easily talk to you forever, but you have something that you have to do next, that you have to stay up late for. And I found that very interesting, because
yeah,
it's you're going to be an online judge.
Yes.
For a magic competition going on in
yep.
Japan?
Yes, it is happening today in hour. In
right.
hour, yeah, I have to be in front of a computer in 30 minutes or 45 minutes. Yes, when we had a pandemic, everybody went to the online, obviously, and
right.
we had no chance, no choice, like, you know, a new world. But also, like, in a pandemic, I kind of took this as an opportunity. So I was almost taking a like, little break from my performing work, because I got kids, and, you know, I married a kid, got a kid, and, you know, now I have two kids. But, like, you know, raising kids is hard. So I decided to have income from my company, which I saved, and, like, but I don't go out. I decided this right before pandemic, and pandemic happened. So.
Oh, wow.
I thought, oh, I was gonna take day off. It's all right. So,
oh, it worked for you.
Yeah, yeah. And I start to, okay, how about that?
Like, I was
like,
gonna stay home anyway.
Yeah, then now let's communicate with the magicians in Japan. I was in Japan with my family, because pandemic forced me to move back. So, and then, you know, I start to do online session for free, and I try to communicate on the social media. And, you know, later I recognize maybe I should make online magic club. So it become online magic club. At the end of the, you know, September or something in the pandemic. Then after that, like, it's already 3 years existing in Japan, but, you know, Japan is a small country, but still, like, far away everywhere, and many good magicians existing usually out of Tokyo, because Tokyo have too much activity, people have a choice to play around. But, you know, if it's outside, if someone have passion for magic, only magic. So there's a lot of good magicians everywhere in Japan. So I met this club and then become together. Also same time before or after, my friend Theater called Osmond, they are already making competition every year, but again, pandemic, so they couldn't do. So they decided to do online competition. And we are doing competition like this. So now I'm kind of present board member and the chairperson of the This Magic Club. And I have like, you know, six board member in Japan. And then also like some international magicians, the international board who is supporting this club. So yeah, this club is existing right now. And the competition is 2 days, tonight and tomorrow night. Happening in Tokyo right now.
Wow, very cool. A lot of cool magic things happening at once. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's great and it's good for many of the people. So, and we have to give something for the future. So,
sure.
Young magicians there and yeah. Many competitors there. And I have to do jury work. Jury work is really tough work.
And you have to focus, yeah.
Yeah, and we have to know it. But I usually say like this, it's maybe sometimes it's offensive for someone, but being jury, so we are trying to act like a god, but we are human being. So which means we are not knowing everything. We cannot know everything, but we have to, because someone has to do judge, otherwise nobody can measure the competition.
Right.
So it means that, you know, jury is mostly everybody working so hard, and so hard to try to be fair for everyone and put number, and every single action changes their life.
Yeah.
So that's why jury have to have a good moral against sword and sheath. So basically we have to have a good moral because we have to decide, commit. But same time we are not perfect. That's why we need several jury to exchange knowledge. Sometimes we have to be honest, have to have a contestant and ask them questions because we don't know. So, but you know, putting away ego, just, you know, focus and also try to give something for this society. So jury people should have a skill set, knowledge, experience, but also good moral. And otherwise, you know, that it's not really right. So, and that's why, like, you know, that I'm trying to be jury this time as well. And, you know, I have to also help other jury as well this time. So,
yeah. That's like very well put. Well, we'll let you get to that, and good luck with that. I don't envy you because I know that's a difficult thing to have to do, especially late at night.
Yeah, I know. Until 5 a.m.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Wow, that's incredible. Yeah. We'll hang out tomorrow when you're done with all of that.
Yeah.
Once you get some sleep, fortunately,
yeah,
you'll get a little bit. But this has been Shudogawa on Something Up My Sleeve, and thank you so much for being part of the
program. Thank you so much. Yeah. Thank you for the invitation.
Awesome.